they've got to find a big-time wide receiver. I mean, I understand that they went out and got Corey Davis in free agent, but I need a one of these college guys in the second round that all of a sudden is a one, but for some reason he becomes a two. DK Metcalf, Michael Thomas. Find me one of those dudes that a young quarterback can grow with.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Key, like if you think of it, like Evan just said too, but you go back a couple years ago, they have tried Corey Davis, Denzel Mims, Jamison Crowder, Elijah Moore. So, like, they've put a lot of resources.
Shouldn't have never let Robbie Anderson get out the building being cheap.
Sometimes the worst evaluations are when you let people walk out your door that can play, and Robbie Anderson's a really good example. Like, he should never have walked out the door, just like Joe Burrow should never have walked out of Ohio State, like, or Justin Fields leaves Georgia. Like, you can't let certain players leave your program, and to me, Robbie Anderson's one of those.
What does this do to the mental evolution of Zach Wilson being out? Like, how much does that hinder him?
I think it's a real positive for the next 10 years. I know for the next 6 weeks it's going to be choppy. He needs to take a half a step back. I think what's been disappointing is I think Robert Saleh's done a good job on defense. I don't think he's managed the game effectively, and here's what I mean by that. If you go back to the first Jet-Patriot game, Mac Jones was average. Any of the four of us could have played quarterback for the Patriots and won that game because Bill Belichick will often say that your opponent will lose the game before we ever have to win it. And when Zach Wilson threw four picks against New England, like, that's not the way to develop a quarterback. Be balanced in offense. They're going to go up and down. We've seen Trevor Lawrence, Justin Fields. They're all going to go up and down. But put him in the best position to be successful. And, guys, Key, I don't know who we should give credit to, but the New York Jets have scored 0 points in the first quarter this season. That is shocking. Like, not to have a field goal through seven games. So something is not working with their game plan, their preparation. And I think to answer your question, Jay Will, I think over the long term, Zach Wilson getting a little bit of a break is a good thing.
I think you should give credit to Mike LaFleur. That's the guy, the offensive coordinator. Give him credit to not scoring because he's the one designing plays and doing those things. I look at, and I told Evan this the other day, I said, I don't know about the staff. Early observations, but I don't know. And people like Joe Douglas. I like Joe too. I know Joe from his Philly days and saw him a couple of training camps when he took over. I went to visit him at training camp. The problem that I have is what's the real plan? You usually have a plan. If you're with me, Mike, we're going to have a plan to start with. We get in our room, we got a plan. Here's what we're doing. We're drafting this young kid, and we're going to have a veteran quarterback to teach this kid what it's all about. Now, all of a sudden, the kid is hurt, and you're going to go trade for Joe Flacco?
Right.
That doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me.
Yeah, and Key, you know what's interesting? And it's obviously a huge tragedy, but like Greg Knapp passing away.
Understood.
You know, in the summer and not having a veteran quarterback, you're not putting – you have a young offensive coordinator who's never called plays. You got Zach Wilson who's just trying to figure out how to get to the facility, let alone learn a pro NFL playbook. Not to have a veteran on the staff, on the coaching staff, or in the locker room, to me, is showing up.
But even with the absence of Greg Knapp, as you know, as a general manager in Max and Jay, when we leave that room, that offensive coordinator is going to staff meetings. Now I need my young quarterback to sit in with that veteran quarterback and go over everything on the board as an extension of the staff that's in the room down the street.
And even more fundamentally, I remember talking to Chad Pennington one day. It was so interesting. Chad was a great player, and he was also a pleaser by nature. And he was just talking about learning to play quarterback in New York City, like who to say no to, how to say no, ticket requests, media requests. And Zach Wilson needs somebody. I totally agree, Key, the wisdom of learning how to be an NFL quarterback in New York.
I want to get back to the wide receiver point you made, too, because the way I think about it, it's not precise like this, but when you draft and when you put an offensive line in place, that's part of the architecture of the team, right? Or, you know, like the way you build the team, you want your quarterback, your left tackle, your defensive end to go get the other quarterback, you know, to me. And then some of the other skills position guys are more like the furniture in the room, right? Key, you'll talk about how you can get a wide out. You don't need to draft him in the first round. You can get a – but the more the vertical passing game or the passing game period is emphasized, and every year it's like emphasized more, the more I think having that number one wide out, that wide receiver, the number one guy, is really part of the architecture. When you can have, if you don't get your young quarterback there, you don't get him a guy like that. How do you really find out about him?
Everybody in the National Football League that has had success. I'll point to two guys real quick. when Brandon Bean realized that Josh Allen wasn't getting, that they were getting the most out of him, what did they do? First Diggs. Thing they did is they said, we're going to get Diggs. I don't care how much it costs. And we're going to pay him so he's happy. Wide receivers got to be happy with their money.
I know that.
Then number two, here's a second team. The Arizona Cardinals, what did they do? They went out and got DeAndre Hopkins. Mm-hmm. They was like, yeah, we got to get a guy. So, and then what happened with Russell Wilson? They went out and got DK Metcalf.
Joe Burrow, they drafted this guy.
You got to have us for your quarterback to be successful. There's no question about it.
Is that part? Has the wide receiver position become part of the architecture in terms of the blueprint of designing a team?
Yeah, and look, the Jets have, like, for 3 years now thrown a lot of resources going back to Mims. Again, Elijah Moore, I think, like, the way Key described the DK Metcalfs of the world, like, a lot of people felt like Moore slipped. But he has the ability to be a one that hasn't worked out yet. And look, Corey Davis, the contract, we'll see if he can live up to that. But I think the Jets have actually tried to address that position. And certainly when you look at, they've drafted offensive linemen in back-to-back years in the first round.
Yeah, Corey Davis is a good player, but he's not a one. Game changer at the position. I'm talking about game changers, Jay.
Right.
Yeah, well, I think that's why I got confused when you guys made mention of, you know, Robbie Anderson and the Jets should have held on to him. I'm like, well, he's probably like the third option for the Panthers now, right? Having optionality.
But one thing I would say about him is he could go hit a home run. He could make the one or two plays in the game. Like a little bit like Hollywood Brown. Like Hollywood Brown, you may not hear anything, and then he makes the one or two plays.
Yep.
Like DK
Metcalf. So a piece, but not the piece.
Yeah, exactly.
Like and that. Not expensive. You're talking in the world of non-spending general managers –
Why are you pointing to Mike D?
I don't know. Talking about overpaid
wide receivers.
He's an $11 million guy. That's not
You're
a lot of money.
You're talking about an elite guy. He means like an elite guy.
I could spend $11 million on Robbie Anderson and go spend another $18 on OBJ and be fine.
Thanks for watching ESPN on YouTube. For live streaming sports and premium content, subscribe to ESPN+.